Thank everyone for coming. I know it's the end of the conference and we're probably all flagging a little bit. My name is Claude Rubinson. I am a sociologist at the University of Houston downtown. And I have I work in a particular method called qualitative comparative analysis. It's a way of doing set-theoretic social research. And I maintain a suite of software packages for this method. And so I was asked to present on it here. Okay, overview of the talk. So I'm going to talk a little bit about QCA, just so that you understand what it is and what it's attempting to do. And then talk a little bit about the existing QCA software and sort of my history in developing QCA software, particularly with an aborted first attempt in writing an R package. And then I eventually moved to Python, which worked out much better for me. And so talk about sort of how this software has developed, and then talk about where Python has worked well and where it hasn't worked so well. And then the stuff that I'm working on right now is developing visualizations. That's something that's really underdeveloped in the QCA world. So that's what I've been working on lately. So I'll give you a look at some of what I've been doing there. And then sort of conclusions about my experience in using Python specifically for academic research. So, all right, so what is QCA? It is a technique for conducting social research that uses Boolean algebra. So where most statistical research is based upon a linear additive model, here we're analyzing subset relationships and using Boolean set theory. Okay, so what kind of stuff does it tell us? Simple example is that religious fundamentalists constitute a subset of political conservatives. That is, religious fundamentalists tend to be politically conservative, but that doesn't mean that if someone's a political conservative, that they're a religious fundamentalist, right? So we have asymmetry here. We have a subset relationship. Similarly, wealthy people tend to come from wealthy families. So we have another subset relationship. The relationships do not have to be perfect. There are certainly wealthy individuals who did not come from wealthy families, and there are certainly individuals who came from wealthy families who are not wealthy. So again, you have this asymmetry, but you know, by and large, there's a rough subset relationship here. Okay. There are two types of relationships that we're really concerned with. One is necessary conditions. The second is sufficient conditions. So a necessary condition is something that must occur in order for the outcome to occur. Okay. A sufficient condition is if the cause is there, the outcome will occur. Okay, what do we mean here? Okay, so necessary condition, you have to be exposed to HIV to contract AIDS, but just because you are exposed to HIV doesn't mean that you're going to contract AIDS. Again, we have a subset relationship here. Okay. Sufficient condition, if the cause is there, the outcome will occur. But there could be multiple causes. So for a pregnancy to terminate, could have an elective abortion, could have a miscarriage, two sufficient conditions. There are other ways for pregnancies to terminate as well, however, stillbirth, for example. Okay. An example from a colleague, a pair of colleagues of mine. She was interviewing recently deported women. So these are women, we did graduate school, University of Arizona in Tucson. And so what she would do is she'd drive down to the Mexico border and interview women who had been picked up. They'd crossed into the US illegally, they'd been picked up, and they'd just been deported back to Mexico. Actually, it didn't matter where they came from, they're going back to Mexico. And so she's interviewing these women, you know, pretty much the worst day of their life, and asking them who they are, all this kind of stuff. But one of her big questions is, what do you plan to do next? Do you plan to go home? Do you plan to try and cross again? Or don't you know? And they ran a QCA on her research. And basically what they found And it's a, there's actually more than just here, but this is a nice way of sort of describing it, so, or a simplified way. So one is that high SES women who haven't lived in the US and are not traveling with women, these women said, I'm not gonna cross again, I'm gonna go home. So, you know, these are women who were well off at home. They don't have an attachment to the US because they haven't lived here. And they're not with their family. Their family most likely is at home. So they're like, uh-uh, this was a bad experience, I'm going back home. Another group was high SES women who haven't lived in the US, same condition there. They've only attempted crossing a few times, and they felt that their last crossing experience was very dangerous. So they were assaulted, they were raped, something happened. These women, again, most of them, I'm going home. Okay. There's an overlap here, right? The high S women who haven't lived in the US, that's in both of these. There's some who sort of were over-determined. Those women are I'm going home. Okay. So QCA is very different than conventional statistical analysis. It, as I said already, it's based upon Boolean algebra, set theory, rather than a linear additive model. There are other set-theoretic methods. Social network analysis is a set-theoretic method. GIS can be used set-theoretically, and a lot of it is, but more or less it's being sort of pushed into a linear additive model. Q&A is a quantitative narrative analysis. This is a way of a method for extracting story grammars from narratives, newspaper accounts, this type of thing, but it's also set-theoretic. One of the interesting things about QCA, because it's based upon Boolean algebra, it is not restricted by degrees of freedom. So it works really well for small sample sizes. And in fact, most QCA applications are on samples of maybe around a dozen to 50 observations, okay? So sample sizes that are way too small for conventional statistics because you're not gonna be able to get statistical significance. It can also be used for large N studies as well, and there's no problem with that. Overall, though, what it does is there's a focus on sort of types, on trying to understand your cases, and it encourages a research process that we like to call retroductive, in that you're moving back and forth between theory and data, trying to sort of figure out what story makes sense given given your cases. Okay, so let me give you a little example of retroductive research. So this is a study from some colleagues, Cliff Brown and Terry Boswell. They were doing an analysis of strike breaking during the 1919 steel strikes. And so they, in this part, they're specifically looking at when would blacks cross the picket line, okay? And so they did their sort of case studies on, I can't remember what, 15 or so cities, steel strikes in about 15 cities. And the two variables that they thought might really matter was, is there a recent influx of black migrants into the city? And how strong is the union? Do you have a weak union? And so they put this data into a QCA analysis. They construct what we call a truth table. And essentially, this gives you the different configurations of your data set. And so what they find is that in this first row, where you had cities with both recent black migration and a weak union, you had black strike breaking, okay? East Chicago, Pittsburgh, Youngstown. The last two are places where you did not have black strike breaking. So the types are a little bit different, but you did not have black strike breaking in those cities. The second row is what we call a contradiction. So these are cities that have recent black migration. They do not have a weak union, so they have a strong union. Four of the cities did have black strike breaking. One of them, Cleveland, did not. And one of the sort of assumptions in QCA is if you've got observations that have similar conditions, similar context, they should behave similarly, okay? And so they look at this, they find this contradiction, and they say, okay, what's going on here? Why is Cleveland different? How is Cleveland different from these other cities? So they go back to their cases. This is retroduction, okay? So instead of just sort of, this is what we're gonna test and here are our results, they go back to their cases, they study it a little bit more. What they figure out is that local government repression matters, okay? Does the local government side with the owners or the strikers? Okay. And so they bring local government repression into their analysis. And all it really does is it splits, okay? It just splits these different rows. So our first row of true, 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 or true, true, that gets split into true, 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 false. Okay. There are no cities that actually are true, true, false here. Cleveland gets split into its own row. Okay? So now we have a truth table free of contradictions. And Brown and Boswell say, this is a more convincing story. Okay? What we can do is we can now reduce this truth table, okay, to Boolean equations that'll tell the story a little bit more cleanly. Basically, what we do is we highlight the those configurations that lead to the outcome. Where did black strike breaking take place? And we can write that as simple Boolean equations where Boolean multiplication means and Boolean addition means or. So basically the equations here say that black strike breaking occurred in cities where there was recent black migration and a weak union and local government repression, or cities in which there is recent black migration, not a weak union, and local government repression. The difference here is obviously just the difference between one group of these cities had a weak union, one didn't. So we can say, you know, that probably is not causally explanatory, and we can drop it out. And so they get to this simpler equation that black strike breaking occurred in cities that had recent black migration and local government repression. So that's how QCA works. And frequently it works in that way of you start your analysis, you see what you have, particularly if you have contradictions, then you go back to your data, try to resolve those, and you're trying to find a story that makes sense given your data, given your understanding of the material. Okay. Writing up the software is a bit of a challenge. The big issues here are that the QCA algorithms are NP-hard, and the complexity it grows exponentially as you add new variables. Okay? The more variables you have, the harder your analysis. It's not actually about the number of observations you have. That's not really an issue. The equations are all actually based on electrical engineering circuit switching theory. So if you're familiar with Carnot mapping and Quine-McCluskey is what we're using here. Okay. Data sets tend to be small, as I mentioned, you don't actually need matrix algebra for this stuff, so I don't actually use NumPy. That's sort of the first question that Python programmers always have. They're like, oh, you're doing sets. You're using NumPy, right? I'm like, no, actually not. And so the issues that I am dealing with when I'm developing this software is, one, how do I encourage this retroductive process where you run the analysis and then sort of go back to your cases, reanalyze them, try to study your cases in depth? And how do I make software that is efficient given these restrictions, useful and usable for my users and for myself, because this is how I do my research as well. Okay. There are a few QCA packages out there. The original, so QCA was developed by Charles Reagan in the 1980s. And so he developed an initial package called QCA, and since then, he extended, the QCA originally was for crisp sets only, so Boolean fields only. It has since been extended to fuzzy sets. And so
Now you can use fuzzy sets, and that's totally fine. I don't have any examples of fuzzy set here. It's not that big of a deal. But so there's a successor, FSQCA, that brings in the fuzzy set analysis. The interesting thing about this, and it sort of tells this nice story about sort of software development and how software development proceeds. So QCA was the first software package for doing this method. And as we know as programmers, the first one has a lot of problems. You know, you're figuring it out, you make some errors, you make it overly complicated a lot of the time because you're still figuring it all out. And QCA's default settings were wonky. Okay, and so one of the things that would happen would be that like contradictions would just by default get dropped. Okay. All of the software that followed that branch did the same thing because they all sort of mimicked the original QCA interface. And so this other software, Tosmana, isn't really maintained anymore, but the R package for QCA, that's growing in popularity and more people are using it. And I haven't checked recently, but in the past, it had the same wonky default settings as the original QCA package. They didn't copy it from the original QCA package. They copied it from Tosmana. And so this kind of stuff sort of happened over and over again. Okay. And then there's a Stata module, and then there is my suite of programs, ACQ, which is my command line version, and Kirk, which is my GUI version. I originally tried writing a module in R. And I do a fair amount of my work in R. I'm not crazy about it. I was pretty happy with it until I started trying to program in it. And R programming is really quite painful. I've got whole rants on that. As an interactive system, it's pretty good, but programming modules is pretty painful. But the big problem that I ran into is it's just slow. R is a slow system, particularly if you're doing loops. And so this is one of the first things that anyone who's doing any R work learns. They're like, vectorize, vectorize, vectorize. You have to vectorize because loops are really, really slow. You can't vectorize QCA. The comparisons are such that you have to do these loops. Okay. The other thing is I was hoping to write something that could be used by other people, and R has a really high learning curve. Okay. So this I ended up throwing away after a few months, probably, a few months of work, and I eventually threw it away. The big thing that it did let me realize is originally I started writing it as a suite of different functions. So, you know, a function to calibrate your data set, a function to convert your data set into the truth table, a function to reduce the truth table. As I was working on it, I realized, no, make this task oriented. So design it so I want to run a sufficiency analysis. I want to run a necessity analysis. That you don't have to think about the functions. What do you want to do? And that's become a defining feature of my software. Okay. So I've got these two packages, which I mentioned. I've got my command line version, ACQ, and I'm pretty sure I'm the only person who uses it. But it makes me very happy to work at the Unix command line and just be able to pipe my stuff around. And then Kirk is my full-fledged graphical program. What's some of the stuff that I want to do with this software? So I'm a Unix person. I want to follow the Unix philosophy. You know, small is good. You should have do one thing and do it well. Interface with text. All these kind of things. I was like, I want to maintain that. I'm looking for performance. As I said, the algorithms are slow. And so I'm looking for performance, but I want to be able to, you know, optimize as well. And Python's been very good for that, actually. I want to support and encourage good QCA research practice. QC still, even though it's been around for a couple of decades now, it's still sort of growing in use, and it's easy to do it poorly, and I really wanted to sort of encourage people to do it well. And then I wanted to make something that could be used by the existing QCA software written by Reagan is Windows only. And so I wanted something for OS X and obviously for myself using Linux. The other thing is, I'm not a developer. I'm a professor. And so my main time needs to be spent doing research. So I need this to be something that doesn't take all of my time. After I threw away the R version, I spent some time thinking about what language I wanted to write this in. I had done Python programming a few years ago, hadn't really touched it for a number of years. Most of the day I live in the Unix shell. I was doing R as well. And so I was like, oh, I could, you know, maybe do Ruby, I could maybe do something else. And then, you know, so I've looked at a few different things. I ended up coming back to Python primarily because of the ecosystem. I'm not a huge Python advocate, actually. I've been pretty happy with it, but you know, I'm not really attached to it. But what mattered was I want to be able to hire programmers to help, particularly with the graphical interface, because I don't do GUI programming. I'm going to have to learn, I think. But I wanted to know that it would be stable, it would continue to be maintained. Python is sort of lingua franca in academia now. It's everywhere, so that's good. I knew I wanted, you know, I wanted good GUI toolkits, cross-platform installer, you know, all this kind of stuff. I ended up choosing Qt for the GUI toolkit because it provides native widgets on different platforms. It's pretty easy to work with, and PyInstaller I've been pretty happy with. I'll talk about it a little bit more. So some of the stuff that it allowed me to do is it's been pretty easy to recruit and hire programmers. I don't have a ton of grant money for this kind of stuff, so periodically they get scooped up. I had a really nice one, and he got hired by Google, and I was like, well, yeah, I really can't compete with that. My latest programmer started his own Haskell company, so he's not being, I'm not able to work with him very much anymore either. I mostly do procedural programming. I do more and more object-oriented programming, but it makes it pretty easy to mix this stuff, which is pretty good. We all know this. Python's online official documentation is really, really good. And for me, this is really important. The core language still remains pretty compact. I can keep it in my head pretty well, and that's important because I'm not doing this day in and day out. The standard library and the surrounding environment, that's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and that causes me more problems. Okay. Unix philosophy, so build a prototype as soon as possible. This is something that Python obviously really helps. I started by writing the command line version, sort of working that out, and then we were able to write the graphical versions. What we've ended up doing is, so ACQ is, it literally is a suite of shell scripts for doing different parts of the analysis. But we realized, sort of as I'm doing it, there are times when I want to be able to graphically visualize a truth table, sort through it, these type of things. Concav is a consistency coverage table. This is the output, the final output of an analysis. And similarly, I wanted a graphical interface because to sort of move recipes around, the different recipes around, and compare them with each other. And so what we ended up doing was writing these shell scripts that could spawn a little GUI window for ACQ, but then they also become part of Kirk. Okay, so you know they're pretty integrated at this point, but that's ended up working really, really well. One of the big things is that I've really resisted adding a data editor to Kirk. And this is something that people ask about because it seems very odd to have empirical research software that doesn't have a data editor in it. And I'm like, no, that is not part of, you know, what I am trying to do here. At the same time, people need to have their data. And there is stuff about converting variables into fuzzier crisp sets. And there is, so QCA researchers do need some way to manage their data. Up till now, I've just said use Excel or use, you know, SPSS or use R or whatever you use. Use that, then export it to CSV, read it into Kirk. Kirk can also read Excel files, so that works out pretty well. What I ended up finally doing, and what I'm working on now, is basically writing a QCA add-on for Google Sheets. And that's actually worked out pretty well. And so now I can say, go to Google Sheets, install this add-on, and it'll give you these functions for cleaning your data, calibrating your data, this type of stuff. And then you can read it into Kirk that way. I'm working on visualizations, and I'm still sort of working through how to integrate that into Kirk, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. One of the tenets of Unix is to make all of your programs filters so that they can read and send plain text, and that actually worked out really nicely because other software, other authors of other social research software have like contacted me. They're like, we want to call out to Kirk. And so we've got a data collection method. We want to be able to call out to Kirk. How do I do that? And I say, you just do it because it can read from the command line. It's not a problem at all. And they're like, oh, okay. So that's actually worked out really, really well. Okay. Performance. So this blew me away. My sort of when I got ACQ, the initial version of ACQ written, it was fewer lines of code than the R package, which is quite, it's not what I expected because R is designed for statistics. So it has the data frame as a fundamental data type. Here, I've got, you know, lists of lists that I'm going through. Python is still fewer lines of code because R has so many sort of edge cases and corner cases that you have to work around. And it was faster. And that was shocking. The current QCA module for R, they've spent a lot of time optimizing. Performance is the big issue. Finally, they gave up and they wrote the core parts in C because they couldn't get it fast enough. But the authors of it contacted me once and they're like, you know, Kirk is really fast. I'm like, no, R is really slow. I spent this summer working on optimizations, and because, you know, there was still a lot of stuff I hadn't paid attention to it at all, optimizing at all for the first couple of years I was working on it. It was working well enough, but optimizing so I can have more variables. I spent the summer sort of working through that, and it's worked pretty well. It took some time. Documentation of how to optimize is not very good online. And there is a lot of potential with projects such as Cython, which I've used a little bit, and just sort of dropping it in improves performance a bit without doing anything else. And then PyPy, which I cannot use because not all of my libraries are supported yet. Okay. So that I don't have to worry about performance really helps me focus on actually how to do the research, how to use the software. And that's been a really, really good thing. The big thing that I wanted to do with this software is really encourage people, and I mean, all statistical analysis, all empirical research is like this, but QCA encourages it more than conventional quantitative research. I wanted to encourage you, the user, to run an analysis, tweak something, rerun the analysis, then compare. Tweak something else, rerun the analysis over and over again, and go back and forth as you're trying to understand what's going on in your data. Okay? And so we really focused on that and on sort of usability, user interface, user experience kind of stuff. What really helps is the whole thing, eat your own dog food. I do this. So I would, you know, be working with them like, well, that doesn't work. You know, things that I thought were the way to do it. There was something, I'm not going to remember the exact thing now. It was something like, I thought, oh, I'll show the absolute number, and it turned out I should show a percentage, or maybe vice versa. But if I wasn't running the analysis myself, I wouldn't have figured that out. All right, so how is this designed? It's Python 2.7, because PyQt required that. I don't know if PyQt's been updated to 3 yet. At some point, we'll move to 3 once PyQt is ready. We've only had very minor issues with PyQt. I've been really happy with it. And one of the nice things is, Kirk, whatever platform you're on, it feels like a native application, and that's been really good. I was never able to build Qt from source on OS X, use Mac ports instead, that's totally fine. PyInstaller has been really good for building and distributing. So one of the things, I don't want my users to have to install Python. A lot of my users are not going to be able to do that. And so PyInstaller bundles everything up into basically a single directory, and along with all the libraries and the Python binary and all of that, and then you can just distribute that. And it's a little large, but that's fine. It's been really good. Originally, there were some issues with OS X where I had to use the development version. That's been solved for a while now. I should probably take that bullet point off. The big thing, this session history, this in Kirk, is what lets you go back and forth and compare your analyses. And that is something that other software does not have. Other QCA software certainly doesn't have. But just in general, statistical software doesn't have something that really allows you to compare your output, compare your different runs. So that's been a really good thing. Okay, so here's an example. This is what Kirk looks like. And this is analysis, and it might be a little small to see, and I apologize. So this is an analysis that a colleague did of when incumbent presidents were defeated in the election. And we know that incumbents and presidential incumbents have a great advantage. So he was interested in what are the instances in which presidential incumbents lose. So here's the original data set that he has. And I've specified my outcome, not reelected. I've checked off the causal conditions that he thought would matter. And we run our sufficiency analysis. And what we see is if you look at, where is it? Okay, in the outcome column, the second to the last, with Taft, Coolidge, and Truman, 48. So this is one of those contradictions. So most of the time, in two of the three instances, the president, the incumbent, was reelected, but once Taft was not. Okay? And so, Bill Winders says, okay, what's going on here? What happened was that Teddy Roosevelt, who had already been president, ran for reelection too. And so he had this internal challenger from his own party, and that hurt Taft. So Winder says that that's an anomaly and says, we're not going to worry about that one too much. We're going to pull them out. The other one here for not getting reelected is Hoover. And Winders argues, again, Hoover's an anomaly because Hoover is running for reelection during the Great Depression. So he's elected, the Great Depression hits. Winder says, no one's going to get reelected during the Great Depression. So he's an anomaly, let's pull him out too. So what we do is we can set Hoover as a remainder that's basically missing data. And we can set that second to last row as false to say that in general, this type of configuration should lead to being reelected. Not being not reelected is what the false means there. Okay, so we run that. And we get our Boolean equations. And what he finds is that there are sort of two different recipes here. So one is incumbent presidents will not get reelected if they are running for reelection when there is a recession and there is a challenger from their own party. Okay, that hurts their chances for a reelection. The other one is if there's a foreign crisis, okay, and again, there's a challenger from with their own party. Okay. And so what Winders argues is that having these internal challengers really, really sort of hurts chances for a re-election. And what I would suggest is it's a sign that the president is weak. Thank you. Okay. All right. So we have our sort of results here. What we don't have is other ways of looking at this data and trying to understand and visualize these set theoretic relationships. The obvious place to go, and what I did earlier, is Venn diagrams and Euler diagrams. We all know those. They're relatively easy to interpret. The difference between Venn and Euler, just in case people aren't clear, Venn diagram shows all the intersections. Okay? Euler diagram shows only those intersections that actually exist. Okay? Problems with these diagrams, however, is that they actually don't provide a lot of information. They're bulky. For what they're trying to convey. As you add more sets and the number of intersections increases, it gets harder and harder to interpret them. And one of the things that we often want to do is interpret these proportionally. We want to say, oh, you know, this set is much larger, this group of people is much larger than this other group of people. The final problem is Euler diagrams are much harder to generate. Venn diagrams, you just need to know the number of sets and then you set it up. That's a solved problem. But generating Euler diagrams is unsolved, and there's active research on sort of how to mathematically, programmatically generate Euler diagrams given sets. And it's a difficult problem. You can do it for two. That's not an issue at all. And there's one solution for doing exact for three sets, but beyond that, it's open. And people are really working on that problem now. Okay, so just as an example, so you can see we've got our classic three-set Venn, four-set Venn, five-set Venn. You can see it gets harder and harder to start sort of representing and using these for anything. Okay, we can go up to five, six sets. Okay, and Edwards figures out sort of how to do Venn diagrams for any number of sets. But you can see it just gets, you know, more and more complicated. Okay, so what do we do? I started here though. You know, if we can do this, because people know them or are familiar with them, you know, maybe we can use them. Okay, so some of the stuff that I wanted to do here is look for area proportional sets and intersections. I want to be able to do subset relationships and understand subset relationships, because that's really what QCA is doing, is understanding these subset relationships. And then, you know, the general goal always is to help users, help researchers understand their data. So the key for me in working on this is sort of recognizing that QCA data sets, calibrated data sets, can be represented as forests and trees, bipartite graphs, and lattices. And so you'll see that that's sort of how I've been working through this. And I implement this as a series of bash scripts and mostly Python scripts that end up generating code in either nuplot or graphviz or tixiz. Tixiz is a graphical programming language. It's mostly used for LaTeX, so some people might be familiar with it. I really like it. Okay, so one of the things that I realized is I could use a spring force model, and this comes out of GraphViz. Here I'm using the Nitto filter. And here I'm including all of the presidents in the data set. And you know, what we can do here is we can basically color this. So we've got our observations, we've got our causal conditions, okay? And if we color this, then we get something like an Euler diagram. Okay? You have to do this manually though, okay? There's no programmatic way to do it. So, you know, load it up into Inkscape and then I color it. And you know, this is all right. It, you know, shows that, you know, most of the time an incumbent gets reelected. It shows that Nixon is kind of anomalous. We see that Taft is kind of anomalous. Where is our friend Hoover? He's over there, okay, down near the bottom. He's a little bit different. But, you know, it takes some time to sort of piece through this, and with all the overlaps, it's really hard to sort of figure out what's going on. It's worse for me because I'm colorblind, so that actually makes it harder too. Okay. If we simplify and only look at those who lost, it becomes a little bit clearer, a little bit easier, and that's fine, and we can color that. And then, you know, okay, we can actually see some stuff better here. So we see that Hoover really is that anomaly. We see that wherever there was a foreign crisis, that is a subset. It overlaps with party challenger, and we see that party challenger is central, and that's exactly what Winders found, right? So that seems to be what's sort of driving a lot of this, that if there's a challenger from within their own party. Okay. This doesn't do a great job of identifying the subset relationships. You can piece it together, but you have to sort of think through it a bit. We can turn these into trees, however, and then we can simply sort of realize, oh, okay, whenever there was a foreign crisis is a subset of a party challenger, so whenever there was a foreign crisis, there was also an internal challenger from the party. There were also instances where there was an internal challenger from the party where there was not a foreign crisis. That's fine. And so we can see that. If we think about our events as subsets of one another, you know, can we think about our actors, our presidents as subsets of one another? And in fact, we can. So what we have here is that Carter and Ford, they had all three of these things happening to them. So Bush is a subset of that, Taft is a subset of that, Hoover is a subset of Bush. So Bush had two, Hoover had one, but you have to go back to your data to sort of figure out what's going on there. In fact, we can combine these into what's known as a Gawa lattice. Okay. Gawa lattices are really useful, but they're a little non-intuitive. So these show the subset-superset relationships, but they're different if you read them down versus up. So if we read this up, what we see is that Taft had an internal party challenge, Johnson and Truman had a foreign crisis and an internal party challenge. Going up on the other side, Hoover had the recession, the Great Depression. Bush had an internal party challenge and a recession. Carter and Ford had all three of those things. So you read them up and you can understand what's going on there. You can read them down and we get that same thing. Oh, wherever you had a foreign crisis, you also had an internal party challenger. And so Gawa lattices end up being really useful for understanding subset-superset relationships. And they're structured, which is nice, unlike the Euler diagrams. So here's the full with all of our presidents. And this gets more complicated, but again, it's more structured, so we can read it a little bit better. So now at the bottom, we have all of our presidents who were reelected. And then we can sort of follow that up and sort of, okay, so Hoover had a recession and he was not reelected. Nixon had a foreign crisis but was reelected. Bush the second had a foreign crisis and a recession but was reelected, and so forth. Okay. And so that's a nice way of sort of demonstrating and understanding these subset-superset relationships. And I would suggest it's a little bit easier to read than the Euler diagram that is trying to capture everything. So, but it is showing the same information. It's just a different way of showing the same information. Okay. There's a simpler way, though. I stumbled onto this. The people who are working on Euler diagrams surf in the corner of one of their web pages. You can just do a linear diagram that just shows, and you just sort of print out the subset relationships. And this is really nice and really simple. So we can see very easily what, so we see that there is a group of presidents who were not reelected, had a recession, had a foreign crisis, had party challenger. We know that those are Carter and Ford. Okay. It extends to be bigger. You know, you can do this proportionally, and so we can see that party challenge is wider, that happened more often. So you can do your proportionality here. That's something that you lose a little bit in the Gawa lattices. And we can also bring in all of our presidents, and it just makes the linear diagram a little bit longer. So this actually ends up being really nice. Thank you. And what you can do, and I don't have it here, on the proportional ones like this, you can also just, along the bottom, put the presidents so that you can see who fell into each of these groups. So that ends up working out really, really nicely, and it's kind of the simplest way, but it took me a while to sort of, well, find it and figure it out, understand what was going on there. So that's been really nice. Okay, so concluding. What have I learned in working on this software about Python? So, big advantages that I found. One, the core language is compact. I can keep it in my head. It's predictable. And so, you know, it's one of these things of like, you know, oh, let me try it. Oh yeah, that worked. You know, that works really well. The documentation is excellent. We know this. But for someone who is not doing this day in, day out, that really matters. I go to the documentation constantly whenever I'm working again. I have been able to find developers, and that's been really good. Sometimes I haven't been able to pay them a lot, but I've been able to find good developers. Good developed environment for toolkits. PyInstaller really has been really nice. Qt I've been really happy with. And performance, really nice. I had good performance with no optimizations, and then spending a summer sort of working on it, and performance is strong. There's still more for me to do, but performance is pretty good. I'm pretty happy with that. Okay, what are the downsides? Big thing is distribution of packages is a mess. With pip becoming the default, that is, I'm hoping, beginning to sort of fix itself, but that's been a problem. And the documentation is sort of haphazard at best. No, I shouldn't say that. Some of the documentation's been good, but a lot of the documentation's really, really crappy. The churn in the standard library has been really a problem for me. The standard library is growing, and there's it's sort of changing out from underneath you. Just parsing command line options, there are constantly new libraries for that. The introductory and intermediate dead tree, documentation is pretty bad. I would say the expert documentation is decent, but sort of intermediate level stuff is really bad. When someone asks me for like an intro book on Python, I can't recommend anything. It's pretty lousy. Online, finding good answers is a chore, and this is a reflection of Python's popularity. The more popular it becomes, the harder it is to find sort of good answers, searching through. The signal to noise ratio is really low, and it's falling. It's very clear to me that's falling. And then the final thing I would say is I think Python does have a problem, certainly online, of being too insular, too sort of focused on themselves, and not as much experience with programming in general, and there is this huge push that's not the Pythonic way to do it. This is the way that we do it in the Python community, rather than, how do we solve our problems? How do we have good development practices? And so a lot of that has to do with sort of, trying to find answers to the questions that I run into is harder than I think it should be. All right, that is all I have. Thank you very much. Question.